last question I wanted to ask you is a fairly general one. It's about the importance of translation in a multilingual nation. Your comments?
Well, you know, we can't be a nation, and nor can we be multilingual without translating, right? And we've become who we've become over 1,000 years and more because that we've been constantly translating between languages, among languages, through languages. A lot of languages have come up through the act of translation. Some of the most defining first works, major literary or philosophical works, have been acts of translation. So as people, we've become what we became through a very intimate contact between languages. Minus that contact between languages, we will not be one people. So the very idea of being one people for Indians is that we are a multilingual people, that we think in multiple languages, we function in multiple languages, and actually modern India has become one of the most multilingual spaces on earth that you could actually imagine. All urban spaces are finally, one way to define urbanity is to speak of it as being multilingual spaces. You cannot imagine a city which is monolingual. The very idea of a city is that it has people from across the country and many other countries who speak different tongues. So, yes, it's fundamental to who we are.
Indeed. And in fact, it's fascinating because in urban areas, there's also such a blending of dialects. So even when there's ostensibly several defined languages, within those, there's entire subcultures. And
Absolutely.
so, yes,
Absolutely.
thank you very
Absolutely.
much.
Absolutely.
Moving on to Gujarati literature in particular and Gujarati nonfiction, would you maybe like to elucidate upon how the Gujarati nonfiction publishing industry has moved thus far and your own personal favorite texts, if any?
No, I think, you know, one that see every language has its own intellectual tradition, and so does Gujarati. These intellectual traditions go through a certain period of highs and lows. I think currently we are going through a particularly bad time in writing in Gujarati, whether it is fiction or nonfiction, and particularly nonfiction. Nonfiction would take but we've had a very robust intellectual tradition in the past of writing about ourselves in Gujarati, whether we're writing our own history, intellectual histories, contemplative works, what you would call philosophical works, or discursive works, which really describe a situation, analyze that. Until about 1950, we've actually had an extremely robust nonfiction prose tradition. And that continued till maybe about 1960s. And after that, we've seen a decline both in terms of social science imagination, philosophical imagination, including writing about economy in Gujarati. I mean, you would expect Gujarat to have, at least it has fondness for money, and therefore it should have had fondness for writing about money. Clearly, it doesn't, right? I mean, we want to make money, but not necessarily write about it in our own language. So we're going through a particularly bad time. But if you were to look at it from, let's say, late 19th century to about 1960, you could think of very major philosophical literary texts that need to be translated, which really would define some of the best that Gujarat has had to offer. And I think my current, I mean, I think my notion of what is my favorite depends upon what one is thinking about these days. And I think one of my all-time favorites, which has not been translated, is Prabhudas Gandhi's most amazing work on the early period of Gandhi's life in South Africa, called Jivan Uparot, which would translate as the dawn of life or awakening to life, whichever way you want to look at it. And it is the only intimate account of both Gandhi family, but also the larger struggle of self-respect in South Africa. And it was something that Gandhi had seen because this was published in the ashram's own little magazine called Madhpuro, which would mean a beehive. So in some ways, it's an authorized text seen by Gandhi, seen by people who were in South Africa, remains unavailable in to readers in any other language. including Hindustani. So I think that would be a very major text that one would think of. There have been very important philosophers in Gujarati. I can think of two very, very major figures. One was, of course, from the Gandhian intellectual tradition, which is Kishore Lal Mashruwala. Now, anybody who's written on Gandhi or written on Gandhi's life is aware of the fundamental interpretative work that somebody like Kishore Lal Mashruwala did. Again, remains unavailable to readers outside of Gujarat. Some of it has been translated into Hindustani or Hindi, but not entirely so. What is really not available is the very, very robust, very profound philosophical and reflective tradition of the Jain scholarship. And Gujarat has, as you probably know, has a very long history of Jain philosophy, both scriptural work, interpretative work, intellectual biographical work, which is really available, initially was available in Sanskrit and Prakrit, and later in Gujarati. And that's something which is not available to readers outside. So you would have very profound scholars of Indology there, like Munijin Vijayji. Now, he is somebody who works with Gandhi to establish the first department of Indology at Gujarat Vidyapeeth. Then Munipunya Vijayji, who established this very grand institution called the Institute of Indology, named after one of the benefactors called Lal Bhai Dalpat Bhai, which is one of the world's largest repository of Jain texts. And so there is a large intellectual tradition which is not available. And I think the kind of effort that you envisage doing would be very important that some of these things come out. Equally importantly, there would be works on aesthetics. I mean, I can think of very, very, very moving personal accounts written by the great painter Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh. And this is part autobiographical, part memoir, part reflective thing about ways of seeing or what he saw as a painter. Right? And that's, again, not available. So I'm saying it's a very contemporary text, beautifully written in Gujarati by a painter who's known not only to Gujarat, but to the rest of the world, and it's not available. So there is both things that are happening now and things that have happened in the past that could actually come out through this effort.
Thank you. I think that is indeed a very comprehensive list, and it delves into various subjects. On behalf of the people who will hopefully be applying, lots of whom we hope will be first-time applicants, where do they find these texts in the original Gujarati?
Oh, they are easily available. They are easily available in any public library. And I know of multiple libraries where these texts are available. None of these are out of print. So and these are very easily can be easily acquired, even for a price. Since we don't value books too much, we price books very low in Gujarat. So they're all below 100.
Okay, great. And I'm sure there's also local bookstores, etc. Yeah. Any other bit of advice you might want to offer to somebody who's perhaps for the first time starting off on something of this type, translating Gujarati to English in particular? Are there any issues which tend to crop up?
No, it's just that translation is an act of scholarship. It's something that people should realize and own up to. A translator is not merely a translator. Translator conveys something much more than only the words printed in a text to another language. You are trying to convey an intellectual tradition. You're trying to convey a certain aesthetic mode of foregrounding language. And I think, you know, that's something that a translator should aspire to do. And those translators who achieve that become who they are. And then sometimes they write, their translations are better than the originals. And I think that's what the aspiration should be.
I would also like if you could comment on the New India Foundation's nonfiction translation program.
I think it's fundamentally important, because there have been initiatives and there is a clear market, and I'm saying a market which has been established in India for translation of fiction from from Indian languages into English and among languages. What has really not happened in a systematic way is to make available knowledge. And when we say nonfiction, we're talking about either social science texts or philosophical texts or memoir literature, you know, reflections on aesthetic concerns. None of these are really available. And I think support from the New India Foundation to do an activity of this nature, make resources available, guide them through the very difficult maze sometimes of pre-publication and post-publication stages in the life of a book, I think would be very crucial.
Thank you so much, not just for this interview, but for your support with the venture and for being part of our Language Expert Committee. I have one final question in the end. Could you tell us your favorite word in Gujarati and how you translate that to English or a phrase?
You know, my the favorite phrase in Gujarati is kasho vaando nahi, nothing matters. And that's how you lead your life.